It is time now to head into the chat room, and joining me today is Sandy Ray in Melbourne and radio host Emily Jade O'Keefe on the Gold Coast. Good afternoon to both of you.
Hi, Emily Jade.
Now, first up today, New Zealand's Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern has been praised for doing such a great job during a horrific time for her country. Look, she's deliberately employed language of empathy, not hate, and chosen a message of togetherness. Sandy, when Donald Trump phoned her and asked what he could do, she answered, sympathy and love for all Muslim communities. I'm sure that's not what he was expecting, but it does go to show there is a place for feminine behaviour in politics. What's your take on it?
Look, there's a place in feminine behaviour in politics and in organisations in general. So I read a very interesting article with the Harvard Business Review in 2007, did an interview and assessed 50 Hybe CEOs in America. And what they found, I'll just read out the quality so that I don't muck it up, they found that they had a profile of women leaders who typically had courage, greater risk-taking, resilience, managing ambiguity, and they also saw them as transformational leaders. So I agree that Jacinda has just been amazing. But can I advocate to empower other women that there are plenty of female leaders out there who also engage these characteristics, but we're not talking about these characteristics as such. So women are transformational, women are engaging. They are different leaders to men. And just because they are different, it doesn't mean to say that organisations should abrogate their responsibility of embracing the different type of leadership that women can give to an organisation.
I agree, Sandy, but as a woman, I think we're always told, you know, to be successful, you need to act more like a man, and perhaps feminine qualities aren't as appreciated in a workforce, and things that may, like, you know, a man making these hard decisions, he'd be seen as strong, whereas a woman would be seen as aggressive. Like, there's a real double standard that's happening. But I think Jacinda has shown that it can be done in a soft but successful way. Emily Jade, Australia, look, we haven't been kind to many of our female politicians. Do you think New Zealand can teach us a thing or two?
Well, in New Zealand's defence, she's not put a step wrong, so there's nothing to criticise with Jacinda Ardern. And look, I do believe we have a lot of great female leaders in Australia. I was a big fan of Julie Bishop, and I'm still sad that she's decided to step down. And she was one of those leaders that really put a step wrong. So I guess what New Zealand can do for us is take the example of Jacinda Ardern being young. Yes, we can trust young female politicians, that yes, young women can take on a job as big as leading a country and be successful at it. And I think that's where we need to look, and that's where we need to learn the lessons.
Yeah, and one that gave birth in office, I might add, too.
I mean, I'm a big
let's
fan.
Not forget she's a mother of a new baby, and, well, you know, I think all of us know what it's like. Emily Jade, you're still in it.
Yes.
Being a mum of a small child is tough at the best of times, let alone
that's
running
right.
a country.
But the other thing we can learn is that her husband took the step back for this time. It doesn't mean forever, but for the time she's the Prime Minister, he's gone, I'll take the baby. And that's another great lesson to learn for all couples everywhere.
Yeah,
I agree.
Can I just
quickly say that women need to be brave? You know, I hear what you're talking about, Amber, about, you know, the traditional stereotype of women adopting men's things. But women need to be brave and embrace what they can bring, both to a family, which is different to a father, and to an organisation.
Yeah, hear, hear. All right, a photo of a woman's AFL star, Taylor Harris, has been targeted by online trolls. It's an amazing image. Here it is here. It captures Taylor
Love
in full
it.
Flight, kicking a football, but attracted hundreds of inappropriate and sexually explicit comments. Taylor hit back, posting the image on her own account, pointing out in a caption, it's actually a photo of her at work. Emily, the fact that this photo has been reshared numerous times and supported Taylor, do you think finally the tide might have turned on online trolls?
Look, I hate trolls. I think there's no place for them. But at the same time, they have helped circulate this photo because of their comments, Channel 7 taking it down, and then everyone going, why would you take down a photo just because of some trolls? And now everyone's putting it everywhere on their Instagrams, and I've actually challenged newspapers to print it as a poster either tomorrow or for the weekend, a big lift out so that kids can put it up on their wall. And I'm not saying girls, I'm saying kids can put it up on their wall, because that is a magnificent photo of a magnificent athlete.
The first thing I thought was, oh my gosh, look at that. Like, I would break in two if I even attempted that.
She's,
I mean,
like,
what an athlete
dancer.
She is.
Yeah.
Sandy, I think Taylor handled this beautifully. But the point is, we've seen countless male athletes in very similar poses to this one, and no one has batted an eyelid. What do you think is behind this backlash?
Look, I think the issue is even bigger than what the obvious of that they're talking about her crutch and exposing and all the rest of it. Let's forget about that. The issue is, why do trolls actually troll? Why are they engaging in this sort of behaviour? What's
Sandy?
In it for them?
Yeah, why, Sandy?
You know, and there's lots of theories. Some say sociopaths, they're psychopaths. No. So a very interesting article from The Conversation said there's two reasons that they've discovered in their research. One was the mood that a troll is particularly in at that point of the time, of day. Mm. And secondly, if one person makes a comment, a trolling comment, then it is twice as likely for someone to follow the lead. Okay. So that's how trolls actually engage with each other and continue to troll. So the mood that they're in of the day.
They want attention.
And also we've now got, you know, computer algorithms. We need to start identifying when these trolls start and shutting them down.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm. All right, we do need to take a break, but stay with us. Still to come in the chat room, claims that unaccompanied kids were put in an airport meeting room to sleep after their plane was diverted. How would you react? And is it bad manners to take a photo of your food? The modern table etiquette debate is next. Let's head back into the chat room with Sandy Ray and Emily Jade O'Keefe. And a Queensland mum is demanding answers after her 9-year-old son, who was travelling unaccompanied on a Virgin Australia flight from Brisbane to Sydney, allegedly slept in an airport meeting room after his flight was diverted to Melbourne. Emily, I know I would even be nervous putting a 9-year-old on a flight, let alone them being diverted and not being able to contact them. How would you feel?
Well, I talked about this morning a lot. I could talk about it all day because I'd be completely freaked out and I'd be going to my husband, how much money do we have? Do we have enough to hire a private plane? I've got to get to Melbourne and rescue my kid. I think I'd be ringing the police and filing a missing persons report because I would have been going out of my mind if I could not contact my child or know where they are. We actually spoke to the mother this morning on air and she did say that they were well cared for. The only thing that let them down is there was no communication. They just didn't know where their son was.
I would just be beside myself. Mm-hmm. 9 years old is so little, and the fact that they didn't contact the mother directly and stay in contact, put the child on the phone, tell me where the child is at all time. I just can't
but
even.
But he looked like he was having a great time. I mean, they made a fort out of cardboard boxes and blankets.
Look, there's no question that he wasn't looked after. I think it was the communication issue, clearly. Sandy, do you think the airline did enough?
No, not at all. I mean, I think this is a basic infringement on human rights. I'll be very clear about this. Is actually, you could issue legal proceedings about false imprisonment. This is absolutely disgusting on Jetstar's behalf. I think it was Jetstar.
No, Virgin.
Virgin's behalf. That there are adults caring for these caring did not have the brains to say these children need to be in a secure accommodation. What are they doing making boxes out of what we're providing? It's outrageous, and I think the parents, I would actively advocate the parents to take legal action.
Yeah, I don't understand. The first thing you would be to call a parent, and my heart would be in my mouth even putting my 9-year-old on a plane without accompanying.
But maybe the child wasn't crying for them. Like, if there was a hysterical child, maybe they'd be like, oh, okay, we've got to get mum and dad on the phone. And
but
maybe
surely that's irrelevant. For 13 hours, these children were unattended in a storeroom. As Amber said, if they were my children, you'd be on the phone the whole time. What's going on? And the grandmother had legal custody of the children because they were signed off, so they allegedly contacted her twice. But that is not the point. There were adults supervising these children and they thought, oh, this is okay, we'll give them McDonald's.
Yeah.
That in itself is
a lot of parents
behavior.
Feel exactly the same way as both of you do today. Okay, finally today, one Melbourne restaurant owner has declared that Aussies have forgotten their table manners. He says his pet hate is customers photographing food, but he also says no one ever listens to their waiters anymore. They push settings around the table, they stack plates and put their napkin on the plate between courses. Sandy says genuinely nice people are being rude because actually don't realise what they're doing is wrong. What do you think?
It's the great unwashed, really, isn't it, Amber? Look, I could not agree more. You know, like, if anything irritates me, nothing more than bad manners, table manners, how people conduct themselves. And I was very strict with my children at home that they had to be taught really good table manners because I expect them to know how to behave themselves when they go out in public or when they have sleepovers at friends' places. They need to know how to look after themselves. I find these people absolutely gross in their misbehaviour, their rudeness.
You're on a roll today, Sandy.
Seriously, I am completely behind the restaurateurs.
Emily, we have around 30 seconds left. Have people lost their table manners?
I'm just going to take a photo of my apple I'm about to eat. Just wait 1 second there. No. Yeah, I think we have lost our manners and I blame it all on phones. Eat your food. It's delicious and you enjoy it more.
And who cares what you're eating tonight?
Yes.
Who gives a flying razoo?
Yeah, I'm a bit, like, I admit I do usually have my phone on the table, but it's because I'm a babysitter usually and you want to be in contact, but I do put it face down. I don't know what the rules are with that. I never photograph my food. I'm always way too hungry to do that.
And how do you hold your cutlery? Can someone teach other people how to hold the cutlery?
Yeah, I'm embarrassed of the food I cook. No one ever sees that.
Emily, Jade and Sandy, it's been great to have you on. Some very strong opinions today.